California.
No matter what you say about Los Angeles, still the only place for me.
It never rains in the sun.
To live and die in LA, where every day we try to fatten our pockets. Us niggas hustle for the cash, so it's hard to knock. Everybody got their own thing coming, see chasing worldwide through the hard times, worrying faces. Shed tears as we bury niggas close to heart. What was a friend, now a ghost in the dark. Cold part about it, nigga got smoked by a fiend. Trying to floss on him, blind to a broken man's dream. A hard lesson, court cases keep him guessing. Plea bargain ain't an option now, so I'm stressing. Cost me more to be free than a life in the pen. Making money off of cuss words.
Hello, hello, good morning. This is Selena Coleman with Real Women, Real Talk. And I got my co-hosts.
Good morning. This is Nasty Nebu. Welcome, welcome. And we have?
Good afternoon. This is Tasty J.
Y'all in the morning.
Yeah, yeah, I did say good morning. Good afternoon,
good
my
afternoon.
Bad.
See how you can be easily misled?
I'm trying to wake up still.
I was wondering
maybe
why she was looking at us like that, like, okay, I'm going to let both these fools just keep on saying good morning.
Yeah, I got mine in this morning.
Yeah.
And had my coffee. Well, but let's go.
I had coffee.
I didn't have coffee.
I'm still
coffee
trying to wake
morning
up, though, still.
Maybe that's why I'm a little still.
You might have needed a waker upper.
Yeah. I got this Pepsi, though. It's going to help me out.
Okay, let's do it.
I like
let's
Pepsi.
Do it.
I like Pepsi. Good afternoon, world.
Yes, good afternoon. So we got a real good show coming up. But before that, let's talk about what did you do this weekend, Miss Janine?
I didn't do much of nothing. I had some things I had to do.
Or how was your week? How about that? How was your week? How was your week, Vanessa?
I had a very good week. I went to a football game at St. Cathedral. They played St. Francis, so both the games was real good.
Well, that's
St. Cathedral run both games. Shout out to C.J. Henry. Nice job. They got a nice quarterback on the varsity team, and he's just a freshman.
Okay.
Number 9, and he had some skills. He can run in the pocket, out the pocket, on the side, like little Bo knows.
Yeah,
so
that's cool.
Skills.
That's cool. So he's university bound, most likely,
yes,
right? University.
Yeah,
bound,
being a freshman playing varsity already.
Oh yeah, good. Yeah, that's so good. That's definitely good.
Nice to look for him in college.
So my week didn't go well. Sunday I wasn't feeling well, and I really wasn't. So Monday took me to the urgent
body
care.
Body pain.
Oh. I thought, you know, I started this new medicine, so I was in urgent care for about 8 hours. Thought I was dying. I was getting sicker by the minute. But by Wednesday, I started feeling better and made it to work and stuff. And so did a lot of meetings, a few political meetings over the weekend and stuff. So
well, that's good to know that you're feeling better.
Yes, I'm
feeling
better.
I gave you some nice little pain pills.
No, I didn't. I don't do medicine if I don't have to. So I stayed away from the pain pills and they did a CT scan and just said everything is good. It's just my body trying to get used to the medicine. The medicine is no joke. So now I'm back on medicine for my diabetes, but I'm going to eat right. And I've been eating right since I went to the doctor.
You've been back to
the
gym?
2 weeks ago. I have not been back to the gym because I wasn't feeling well. And Sky was going to the gym and leaving me, though.
What?
Okay, that's good.
She only do a few reps.
Yeah.
Then she out of there.
She do some laps in the pool, I think.
Oh,
yeah, but
God,
I didn't do anything. I was being lazy with it, hurting and stuff. So now I'm feeling better. I'm going to make it back to my therapy and back to the gym and stuff. So,
okay, well, that's good.
Well, I didn't do much of nothing. I did some window shopping, went and touched on a few things, filled on them.
wishful thinking, like soon.
Soon.
Preparing your wish list.
Yeah.
I'm on this thing. I don't want to spend no money. I don't want to buy nothing. I don't want to. I just want to save it.
That's always a good plan.
I don't know when I got there, but in this past few months, it's like.
You can never go wrong with saving.
Yeah. When I didn't have the money, though, I wanted to shop. So it's backwards. I'm like, I could buy this, but it could stay there. I don't really want it. Or I want it, I don't need it. I think that's my thing this go around. If I don't need it, I'm not trying to get it. So I'm like, keep the money in the bank. But I am going to D.C. in January. So.
Oh, are you?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
What's going on in D.C.?
Well, the inauguration. So I'm planning on being there if Hillary become president, because she'll be the first woman president. And if...
I want to go. You've been saving for me?
I ain't been saving. Oh. I already bought 4 tickets. So it's going to be me, my 13-year-old, my husband, and my grandson.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I'm leaving a few people behind.
Yes.
You can
I knew your Sky's name.
You ain't going to care. You can pull one of them out and put me in.
Which grandson, Chaney?
Of course. Yeah. You know the little one. Yeah, he won't appreciate it. He'll be like, I want my mama.
Yeah.
Is my mama coming, Grandma? No, she at home. Well, I want to go home with her. Well, we can't put him on the plane by himself, so we wouldn't. That probably wouldn't work out.
I can get on the plane
out.
By myself.
Yeah, I think we're going to have fun, though. I want to go to the Spy Museum.
Okay. Yeah. We'll take us lots of pictures.
Definitely, definitely. I've been there once.
Don't take me nothing. So. If you ain't taking me with you, I don't
want to
see no pictures.
I don't
yeah.
want
to. And then we're going to go to the Black Heritage Museum that just opened up.
Okay.
Yeah, I see some things there. So I'm planning. Now, first off, when I'm saying I'm going, I need to build up some time before my job be like, mm-mm, she ain't going nowhere.
Yeah,
denied.
She ain't got the time.
Denied.
Then we'll get your ticket. Somebody,
right.
your
right.
ticket.
I'm available. I'm available.
They're going to be like, she ain't got time on the books, but she planning a vacation. Yeah, so I'm working on that. Working on getting time on the books.
Well, that's
so, not it. Yeah. And my homegirl is... having a wedding. She's already married, but she's having a wedding. And
in
so,
D.C.? As
not
well?
In D.C.
Oh, okay.
In December in Vegas. So okay. we're going to head to that. It's going to be it's gonna be nice. It's going to be a Raider wedding.
Oh, oh really? Wow. Okay.
That's what
that's
I
their
different.
Thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
All I don't the like to see pictures of that.
True yeah. Raider fans. Huh?
True Raider fans.
Die hard.
Die
like,
hard.
E like yeah,
they're winning around that. What's their yeah. record? Are they winning?
All right,
they
well,
won a couple of games, huh?
I don't know. I'm not a Raider fan like that.
I don't think they was.
Yeah, they won. They've been doing good.
Yeah, they're okay. not as bad as they used to
that's
be.
Good. Oh, shout outs to Sly because she a Raider fan and that's her team. So, all right, okay. but we're about to take a break and when we come back. We're gonna get serious on some domestic violence.
Shit done got real, shit, I need to get away, so take me away. When the devil playing, gotta know he playing for keys. That's why I'm not here slipping never. Never, never love life, but I'm with whatever. Mama tell him I was raised up in Compton. Darn that, cheddar block, throw yours up if you don't think that this a better block. Weed man, plus my little homies pedal rocks. Speed bumps, let you know that this the ghetto block. All love, yeah, all of us folks. But you know you're real, you stay in the bloodhood, but you bring over loads. And nobody trip because it's respect always, every time. Bitches ain't shit, so I don't change for these dimes. Dogs on decks, got K's for them nines. Missing is the tickets, brought change for the fines.
I'm crazy and I don't know why. Out here living like a nigga can't die. Smoking and drinking, daddy ain't day. Shit done got real, shit I need to get away. So take me away. On a play, just heard I got a baby on the way. My ex and my best friend on a date. I wanna flex, but I'm too real to hate. Fuck them both, shit, I'm better off without them. Lure my dealer raw hand, but I won't never ever doubt them. Fucking with me, let me hear you holler. Living for the day, cause we ain't guaranteed tomorrow. So I'm out here stunting, trap stay jumping. Legalize a bridge so they can't say nothing. Smoke like a train, yak to the brain. Keep a nigga from going insane.
About to go crazy.
Take me away. Hey yo, I don't even know you and I hate you. See, all I know is that my girlfriend used to date you. How would you feel if she held you down and raped you? Tried and tried, but she never could escape you. She was in love, and I'd ask you how. I mean, why? What kind of love from a nigga would black your eye? What kind of love from a nigga every night make you cry? What kind of love from a nigga make you wish he would die? I mean, shit, he bought you things and gave you diamond rings, but them things wasn't worth none of the pain that he brings, and you stayed. What made you fall for him? That nigga had the power to make you crawl for him. I thought you was a doctor, be on call for him. Smacked you down cause he said you was too tall for him, huh? That wasn't love, baby girl, you was dreaming. I could've killed you when you said your seed was growing from his seed.
Love is blind, and it'll take over your mind. What you think is love is truly not. You need to elevate and find.
Love is blind,
and it'll take over your mind. What you think is love is truly not. You need to elevate and find.
I don't even know you when I kill you myself. You played with her like a doll and put her back on the shelf. Wouldn't let her go to school and better herself. She had a baby by your ass and you ain't give her no help, uh-huh. Big time hustler, snake motherfucker. One's born every day and every day she was your sucker. How could you beat the mother of your kids? How could you tell her that you love her? Don't give a fuck if she lived. She told me she would leave you. I admit it, she did. But came back, made up a lie about you missing your kids. Sweet kisses, baby ain't even know she was your mistress. Had to deal with fist fights and phone calls from your bitches. Lost like you possessed her, telling me to mind my business. That it was her life and stay the fuck out of it. I tried and said just for him I keep a ready clip.
Love is blind, and it'll take over your mind. What you think is love is truly not. You need to elevate and find.
Love is blind,
and it'll take over your mind.
All right, again, this is Selena Coleman with Real Women, Real Talk.
Nasty Nebu, Real Women, Real Talk.
Tasty J, co-host, ready to come on and do this.
Real Women, Real Talk. So, like I said, our topic today is going to be on domestic violence. For me, domestic violence is personal. I would say very personal. I have... my mom used to be in domestic violence situations long before I existed. So by the time I came along and she was with my father, she wouldn't put up with being her anyone putting her hands on her, period. And so I seen domestic violence more on a two-party hand. I say my dad saying something that my mom not liking and my mom quick to pick up something, a pan, a knife, a toaster, something. So for me, domestic violence is close. But in 1999, matter of fact, the year I started working for the county, one of my close cousins, he did a murder-suicide where he actually shot his girlfriend in the head and then shot himself in the head. And that was my first real experience as an adult dealing with domestic violence. And so for me, domestic violence is real. It's emotional instability. So it has to do with mental illness, I feel, also, because it don't just start there. There's ways that it starts and it gets deeper. And so, you know, it starts out with, why you got to go over there to... No, you shouldn't have to go nowhere, or you don't need nobody, or you're good where you're at, basically controlling behavior. But there's signs before it gets to the point where it's murder. And so anybody out there in a domestic violence situation or knows somebody in a domestic violence situation right now where there's a just say no campaign or no means no campaign, and it's not only about rape anymore, it's... They used to say, it's not my business. Well, it's everybody's business if we want to keep somebody alive and stop a murder. And just recently, a family member was killed for domestic violence, and it brought all this fresh to me again and made me see everything a little closer. I've always been doing this show. I've been doing this show for a minute now. We just recently changed the name because we're trying to help change the world with all the domestic violence going on and the violence in the world, you know, with black-on-black crime, police killing our people. And after researching this domestic violence stuff, black women are the number one people being killed through domestic violence at a high rate. And it's crazy because California has a low percentage rate, but we have the highest number of females being killed. Our numbers for 2013 was 186 women killed by a man. And it was either 92% of that 186 murders were by men that they were intimately in a relationship with. And the rest of them were strangers. But it was still considered domestic violence because the way it was perpetrated, that man tried to rape her or, you know, do something sexual with it. But it's sad. So I'm going to open it up to you guys. What do you guys have to say about domestic violence?
Well, I take domestic violence very serious. Starting last month. It's always been serious, but as of last month, as you guys know, me and Selena's cousins, my niece was killed by, they labeled it domestic violence, and I guess it would be because she was in a relationship with the guy. But, you know, the relationship was fresh. She met him on Facebook. Mm-hmm. He was in jail, and of course he wined and dined her. And we don't take the signs serious. You know, they want these to seclude you from your family. They want just, you know, it to be you and them. Them are all signs and tips of something is wrong. You know, women need to get to know these guys. And it is domestic violence whenever you in a relationship. But you don't even know these people. You in these so-called, so-in-love relationships, you know, and she didn't even know the guy. And all the signs was there. Before he killed her, he tried to make two other attempts.
Oh.
And the last time was 2 weeks before he killed her. She died September 7th. Her birthday was September 3rd. They were out, you know, for her birthday weekend at a room and this, that, and the other. Then what happens 4 days later? What changed 4 days later? If you guys was just so in love 4 days ago, what happened 4 days? The signs are all there. He didn't just wake up on the 7th and decide he's going to kill her. He showed those signs. And when you see those signs, stop taking them as a joke and stop. You know, I have been, I guess you would say, in some domestic violence relationships too, but I didn't think it was that serious. You know, sometimes I was the aggressor. But when I look at it, after losing my niece, you know, them were all signs. Yeah, I did some things. He did some things or whatever. You know, when you coming from this background, as me and Selena know, because we are cousins, we're not afraid. You know, it's like, what you going to do?
Yeah. Right.
Because I'm going to do this.
To pop off.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
Already know. You know, she grew up. She's the only girl. All boys. And then I have brothers that's, you know, macho. So, you know, I grew up pretty tough, thinking I can hold my own and handle my own. But, you know, there's always somebody out there that's even tougher. And when you're dealing with a sick-minded person, you know, when they gonna kill you, they gonna kill you.
Yeah, right.
No matter how tough, how macho, how bad you think you are and how untouchable.
Right.
No, it wouldn't have happened if family would have been around, but he tricked her into going over to his uncle's house, and he was in there hiding, and he killed her.
Oh.
But the signs were all there. They were there.
You know what? And it goes back to, you know, what you just said right there. I think I'm not going to say my first domestic violence relationship was when I was 16, because it wasn't. Because when I had my first real boyfriend and the relationship was controlling on my end, you know, like, oh, no, you're not going to do this and you're not going to do that. Not even realizing that that's part of domestic violence, controlling somebody, mm-hmm. trying to tell them where they're not going to go. You know, oh, you trying to leave. I'm going to jump in front of the car and be silly. But when I was 16, I dated a guy 26. And he told me what street I was and wasn't going to walk down. And like you said, I'm not afraid. I can walk down any street I want to. This right. is my neighborhood. So I was walking down Martin Luther King to my brother's house. He lived on Martin Luther King. And he drives down Martin Luther King and he see me walking down Martin Luther King. Now he's married, got kids. He get in the back, snatch me in the car, snatch my shirt, rips it. But then he gives me a black eye. So now I'm hiding from my family. By the time they see me, it's been 2 weeks. And I said, it just happened yesterday. So can you imagine how my face looked? And of course, my brothers was pissed. They wanted to kill him. But I said, I'm in love, right? Mm-hmm. What did love got to do with it? You know, right. So that wasn't the end of my relationship. So I stayed in it for a little while. But I'm blessed because when I met my husband, I was an aggressor. And he was patient and he was mm-hmm. soft. Not always soft, because by this time of my life, I needed a man strong enough that would protect me from my brothers and not my brothers tell me where I can and can't go, being the youngest of eight, you know, yeah, and my brother yeah. right above me, used to try to kind of control me, not in a sense where he didn't want me doing what he was doing. But at the same time, we both came from that life where, you know, when you don't have everything at home, you go out and get your own. And so I was used to going out and getting my own, and he didn't want that.
But did you hear what she just said? He was married, in a yes. relationship, but still controlling her.
Definitely.
You know, and then, ladies, when you guys get with someone and they quick to make a commitment, that should be a sign right there. Because my thing is, I've been with my spouse. I met him in 2004. We just moved to the next level as far as marriage and things like that go. And because why? I have something. You know, a person that don't have nothing, they going to be ready to get married quick. Who going to go marry somebody you just met? You just met this person and it takes time to get to know someone. If you with someone and they're in jail, you met them in jail, you don't know him.
Right.
The real him going to come out when he's out on grounds and you can get to see who he is. Yes, he loves you. Who else he got that's going to run for him, that's going to sit on the phone with him, that's going to send him packages? You, fool. You.
Right. And then there's something about this.
So, yes, he love you.
Well, right. I think domestic violence is real. I grew up in a household of domestic violence. I didn't see it, but I know what ass whooping sound like.
Right.
You know, so it's, and it was never talked about. It's nothing no one ever talks about. I never even asked no questions.
Right.
But it made me grow up in a man I'm dating can't really even holla at me, because it sounds like an ass whooping coming. So I know how to pick my battles and watch my mouth. I know how to pop off on the phone.
Right.
I'm not going to pop off in your face where you could two-piece me. No.
Right.
I know how to tone it down, because yeah. I'm a little lady. But I don't never in my mind thought I could whoop a man. So I'm not going to put my hands on him like that, because I don't want him putting his hands on me.
Well, you know, that's funny you said that, because in my current relationship, I thought I was Billy Badass. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And my husband would accept it because he didn't want to hurt me.
Mm-hmm.
And not until I realized, and he gave me this look one day like, I'm not supposed to take you touching me no more.
Yeah.
Like one time, I never forget this. I balled my fist up and I went all the way back and I hit him. And when I hit him, he started laughing. You know, that made me more mad. But he said, babe, when you the way you roared up, I thought you was about to put me to sleep.
Felt like a little bee sting.
Yeah, felt like a little bee sting. But I'm blessed because he used to tolerate that. And him tolerating it and not fighting me back, we didn't become an abusive relationship. It slowly let me stop being an aggressor in our relationship, not even realizing I'm being an aggressor in our relationship. And I love this man. Yeah. I never wanted to hurt him. You know what I'm saying? But you got me upset about something. You know, one time he took this soda and he was like, you want the soda? You want the soda? You want the soda? You want the soda? And then before he gave it to me, he shook it. and I threw the soda at him. The look in his eyes, I thought he was going to beat the shit out of me. He was like, can I talk to you for a minute? Let's go upstairs. We need to talk. I was like, what a conversation, because I wasn't used to that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm
yeah.
saying? So, I mean, if it would have been vice versa and he threw that soda at me, I would have been trying to get a knife, a bat, you know what I'm saying? And it would have been something way out.
Well, see, that's the key word. You said you wasn't used to that. And like these women, they're not used to, you know, a lot of people is not used to attention. So, you know, if you got someone that's giving you all this attention and they love you because they just met you, you know, 72 hours ago, you know, and they love
doctor
you.
Doctor attention.
It's just right. fresh love.
And, you know, but it's the attention, but you got to read between those lines. You know, all that attention that they give you, regardless of what kind of attention it is, you need to see if it's the right attention.
Definitely.
I think the men need to do a little more loving and understanding and relationship with their daughters.
Definitely.
And be the man that, the example for them, for their daughters to choose their man. You
right.
know, set their standards, set their bar. Let them see how a man is supposed to treat a woman.
Exactly.
How a man is supposed to love and nurture a woman. But a lot of us don't get that.
Right.
A lot of them don't have a man in the home. And if they are an abusive, then sometimes they feel like, well, that is love.
Exactly.
My mother's staying around. So right. maybe that is what I'm supposed to receive in a relationship.
And that's the thing. You know, people who don't have love at home and in their family,
They look for it elsewhere.
They look for it elsewhere, but also the abuser, he don't know how to love.
No.
Right.
And then
no.
we think that we're somebody special. We think our little cootie cat is made of gold and we the special one. Oh, we gonna change him. I'm gonna show him what love is. He need to be loved. Sometimes they need help.
Right. And that's the key thing.
They need help.
I'm gonna change him. No, you can't yeah. change
he
him.
Can't
you
change
can't change him.
He
gotta change himself. Exactly, exactly. Or that female that's out there being the abuser, like myself. You
well,
know what
I'm
saying?
Well, now they have that new law, even don't put your hands on nobody.
Exactly.
It's yeah. like taking women to jail, everybody.
But you
yeah,
know what
definitely.
Somebody told me when I was in my 20s, we was having a conversation. And this guy said that, he was an older guy. He said, and he was stuck. He said, because the women that's under 30, he said that they're not mature. And he said he don't got time to be teaching no woman, you know, how to keep her hygiene up. He said, and then a woman that's over 30 already set in her way.
Mm-hmm.
So who she is who you going to get.
Yeah.
And I didn't understand that because I was in my 20s. I was prime. And it's like, what? Because I know everything. You know, don't ask Janine. Tracy J knows everything.
Yeah.
Always remember that.
Right,
I think
right.
I know everything.
Yeah.
But
been there, done that a few times in
but
my
when
life.
I got over 30 and I started meeting people and seeing that it dawned on me what he said. People are set in their ways. So if you got this guy and he hasn't been loved and he don't know what love is, the only thing you could do is get online and get him the resource that he need, counseling, and leave him alone. Put yeah. him in the professional's hands or put her in the professional hands, because it's going to be hard to show her what love is or show him what love is at this point in time in life. So they might need to land somebody's chair and get their head and mind right.
Definitely.
And you're not that one. You don't have the pot of gold.
Yeah.
You know, you might think you look
well,
like
if
Beyonce.
You did, it wouldn't be going upside your head.
But
yeah.
even with that, you know what I'm saying? Because, I mean, I'm not going to say I see it every day, but I do see it every day because I work for social services. So I know the woman coming in with these big old shades and it ain't sunny outside. Or you can even see through those shades because they got a big-ass black eye, regardless of what the reason is.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And sometimes it's not domestic violence. Sometimes it's you carry yourself as a thug in the hood and you out there fighting and scrapping behind bullshit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Or you just caught up in somebody else's bullshit. But the reality is there are signs. You got bruises on your arm or your face is swollen. Why you got a bruise down here that your makeup can't cover?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So we do see it. I mean, me in my field of work, I do see it. And because I work for social services, I wanted to be a social worker when I first started working for social services. So I took a lot of classes. I took human service classes, you know, social service classes, domestic violence classes, victimology, you know, what makes a person be a victim and stay a victim versus overcoming that. You know,
that's a good question, because I got a call. I seen my phone ringing about 11 o'clock at night, friend of mine or whatever. She called a few times, but I just cut it off because sometimes she get drunk and she just calls.
Yeah.
And then she started calling me the next morning at 6 o'clock in the morning. So I said, OK,
something might be wrong.
Yeah, something might be wrong. I answered the phone and, you know, she's older than me. I'm 44 and she's older than me. And the guy she's seeing is older than her. And she said that he laid hands on her.
Uh-oh, two-piece.
Yeah, he laid hands on her. And then he, not only did he lay hands on her, he locked her in the room and took her keys and wouldn't let her leave. And she said, well, what do you think I should do? Mm. You know, she said, I need to talk. I said, why are you calling me? She said, because I need to talk to you. I need your opinion. And I said, well, what do you want me to do? I'm not a professional.
Yeah.
You know, and if somebody whooped your ass,
she should have been calling 911.
Yeah, is he in jail? She said, no, I forgave him. I said that I forgive you, too, for calling my phone like that. I'm going to forgive you for calling my phone like that, and I'm going to tell you like this. Please don't call. I'm not the police, because if my put his hands on me, you'll probably see it on Facebook. 911 picked him up, and I might go live on it. Because it's a place for people to put their hands on you, and if you're forgiving him, there's no advice I can give you.
Yeah.
Y'all already squashed it. What is you calling my phone for at 6 o'clock in the morning while I'm trying to have my coffee?
She need to try to go.
She was like, because you're a good friend of mine. And
run,
I said,
girl.
Yeah. Yeah, but I'm not a counselor. Right. And I'm not damn sure not the police.
Well, she didn't really want counseling because she wasn't going nowhere.
She just wanted to talk.
Yeah, she just wanted somebody to know he didn't kill her this time.
Right. But the next time, Mike.
Yeah.
And then if it's to that extreme already, you putting hands and you locking them in the room, taking keys, saying you ain't going nowhere.
This is a fresh relationship, too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I wonder how she get in the closet. He say, go get in the closet, or just throw her in the closet.
I didn't ask.
You'd have to knock me out to get me in the closet, locking me in no damn closet, and give me my damn keys.
When I get loose, he's going to jail. Because like you said, there's that no more.
Yeah.
Don't put your hands on nobody. Don't put your hands on me at all.
Yeah, I grew up with seven brothers. So my brother right over me, we fought all the time. And I wasn't taking no ass kickings, period. You know what I'm saying? Like, that was me. You're not going to put your hands on me. You're not going to tell me to shut up. God gave me a mouth to talk. You know, and so that cause.
You was just a tick, tick, boom.
Yeah, I was.
Tick, tick, boom.
She was something else. But no, I grew up in the hood, and I took a lot of ass whoopings. All my friends was three years older than me, so they beat my ass all the time because I always had a big mouth, but I wasn't scared of them.
Right.
They whooped my ass. Like one friend, she whooped my ass every day. I think she liked it whoop my ass.
That was not your friend.
No, she was my friend because then when she
beat me up every day.
Yeah, every day she whooped my ass, and then my brother whooped her ass. You know, he find out she whooped my ass, or if he see her whooping my ass, he jump in and beat her ass, and that's how it was. But it did make me stronger, because by the time I got, you know, sixth grade, I was whooping the shit out of her ass. You know, but not realizing, like you saying, like every day, why would you want to beat somebody up every day?
Yeah, I was about
and then
love.
She was like,
oh, I wanted friends.
She'd be like, I'll beat you up again.
I want to play dolls and jacks. I want to be in
the
back.
I wish I was
only
playing dolls and jacks.
No,
you know what I'm saying?
Girls, y'all could have been my friends. Yeah. Y'all got too many occasions.
No, we played dolls and jacks, but you know, something might happen in the mix. I might beat her in the jacks. And then she want to take my jacks and then, you know, bully me because I was third grade. She was sixth grade. All my friends was always older than me, you know. So then they, you know, back then I was little. So, you know, and then plus, you know, third grade, sixth grade, you know. But once again, you know, she was the aggressor. But I mean, sometimes I was too because I wasn't scared of her. I just couldn't beat them up. But I got them. Oh, you know, I had, you know, not realizing like I had a fight when I was pregnant with both of my kids. Like one of my friends, rest in peace, she just, you know, passed away a week ago or whatever, I fought her 5 months pregnant. Mm. And she was much bigger. And then I fought another one when
so
I was pregnant with my son.
How about y'all share with the people where y'all went and got y'all therapy?
I mean, just over time, you get older and you just
you
realize.
You can learn.
I'm going to tell you
where I got my therapy. I got my therapy getting educated.
Okay.
I think when you got that job, you changed. Because you were something else, Selena.
Yeah, I was. Yeah. But you know what? Part of that is I was in transition before I got the job. Because God wouldn't have blessed me with that job if I wasn't. Because if not, I'd have been fired. I'd have whooped a few bitches' ass on the job. So he knew what he was doing before he gave me the job. So my transition came a little before that. But I'll say school. Because once I started getting educated, and I my hat is out to everybody that's still in school. If you fresh out of high school and you going to college, or if you 40, 50, or 60 and you going to college, the more you learn book knowledge.
60 is pretty old, but go ahead.
I graduated high school with somebody 60-something, but anyway, we're going to take that back. But
let's stay on the topic.
Yeah, y'all just going to share them
referrals
and resources where y'all went and got that help.
But the education is important, and I say that, like I said, I took victimology because I didn't want to consider myself
a
victim.
Let me cut you off. That's the whole thing. Share where we got the help, because as I got older, and plus I have kids, I started realizing I needed to change my ways, because I was something else myself. And I realized I started needing to change my ways, but that's the whole thing. And moving back on that topic, if a person is a certain age and they still live in a certain life, you cannot help them. You're not the person. You're not a counselor. You're not a psychiatrist, so you have to, watch those signs.
Definitely.
You got to watch those signs, because I changed myself. I wanted more. I wanted better. And I'm in a really good place in life right now.
The controlling and the want to tell you what to wear, what else can we look for?
I'll say this. Moving quick to commit. You know, a person who got something going for themselves, like right now, I have a lot of positive things going for myself. I'm not quick to commit to someone I just met.
Yeah,
I'm just barely committing to someone I've been knowing since 2004, 2004 or 5. I'm just barely ready to take that step. So if I would have met him this year, no, I'm not going to be ready to get married. You know, then they want to move in right away. It took us a while to move in together. You know, and then they watching you and seeing how other men are looking at you, and then they ready to pop off or do something. What that nigga looking at? Why he looking at you like that? We take it as, ooh, that's attention. That's the wrong attention.
And sometimes they can be more, what do you call it, like, they always want to say you're up to something or you're doing something. It's a constant, what are you up to? Why do you got to go over there? Why do you got to be on your phone all the time? Why do you have to be?
But that's control. That's control. That's him taking control. And then me personally,
always
I feel like,
finding.
Yeah, at my age, can't nobody, nobody. You know, they'd be like, oh, why are you with that? Why you want to hang with that hoe? Well, why is you worried about that hoe?
Right.
You should be worried. You know, why is you worried about who I'm hanging with, what I'm doing?
You have to worry about them trying to pick your friends.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Pick your clothing.
Definitely.
Tracking your time. Well, it only takes you 5 minutes to get there.
Why are you late?
Run.
Why are you late?
Yeah, that right there, that's going to, moving back to my niece, the guy who killed her. I remember over the summer, my sister said, did you tell anybody that she made banana pudding in my... And I said, huh? She was like, yeah, because he called... She said he called and was like, oh, how was that banana pudding you made at your mama's house? You know, you made banana pudding at your mom's house.
Yeah, and they need to know everything you do. Everybody you talk to, you're every minute.
Every minute.
So you because have to
they
be careful
trying to,
about that.
You really got to be careful. Them is all signs.
Well, Slim
but you
want to
know
nice
something?
List, and it has.
Oh, they're gonna be nice and charming. They're gonna be nice and charming in the beginning too. They're gonna wine and dine you. They're gonna do everything to gain you, and then once they get you, then you'll start seeing a change.
But you know what? There's signs out in our schools that we don't realize. You know, this No More Bullying campaign, it came from somewhere.
Mm-hmm. The bullies.
Right. But where do they learn to bully from? A lot of people... A lot of kids, either they've been bullied or they witness people bullying people. And the majority of the time, it's within their home without even realizing.
In school, when they go to school.
Right. But I'm saying before, I'm talking about the bully at school, that's bullying. Most times it's learned from within their house without them even knowing it. Like, okay.
Well, like you said, with your siblings.
Definitely. Definitely. Or with my mom and my dad fighting. My dad was trying to bully my mom. She wasn't accepting that. So then she became the aggressor in a relationship. So it affects the kids because, of course, my mom, she wasn't taking no more shit. So as a female, it taught me, I don't care if you got 7 brothers, you don't take no shit. And so I never was a bully. Maybe I did bully once or twice in school, but they deserved it. No, just kidding.
Yeah,
I mean, but you don't realize. And like you said, the bullying, whereas in it's controlling. We're trying to control somebody to make them do what we want them to do. And, you know, and it start at school is considered bullying, but them are signs that something is wrong and your child needs some help.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Or you need some help.
Yeah. Exactly. But then it's not always, I want to say it's the circumstances. So.
We're going to take a break right quick in 5 minutes.
Now let's do the break. Let's take the break now. When we come back, we'll discuss some ways
we'll
to get out of
signs.
It. Definitely.
In a little tent, oh, and just like the river I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. And I say, brother, help me, please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Lord, there have been times that I thought I could last for long. But I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
All right, so this is Selena Coleman with Real Women, Real Talk, and we are talking about domestic violence, and this is Domestic Violence Awareness Month, so we're back on board with, we want to give you guys some solutions and some tips if you are in a domestic violence relationship. For the people that don't know, or I'm not going to say for the people that don't know. This is just some good information. If you're in a domestic violence relationship and you're trying to get out and you don't know how to get out, there's different organizations that can help you. They got a helpguide.org that helps battered women and battered men get out of domestic relationships. And they give you tips of what you should need. You know, like you want to take your ID and your Social Security card. And if you got kids, their shot records and birth certificates. And if your mate is always keeping track of that type of stuff, also you want to get duplicates and you want to put it in a folder and you want to make sure you can take that stuff with you if you need to leave at a moment's notice. They have battered women shelters, battered men shelters. And if you need to leave immediately and you think it's your life is dependent on it at that moment, you know, we hate to say call 911, but that's a reality. Sometimes you might need to call 911.
And if you just need someone to talk to, they also have a hotline, 1-800-799-SAFE, 1-800-799-7233. Also, you know, they have, like she said, battered women shelters, and if you have to go, leave everything behind. Pack what you can and get your kids out. Go out of state. There's always a family member or a friend that you can run to. But don't think staying around and it's bad. You know when it's bad. And, you know, if they're stalking, you got to go. It's time to leave.
Yeah, and if you have a church home, go and get you some prayer with your pastor. They also have referrals, and some churches have help, but always get some prayer so you can get some strength to make the choices that you're going to need to make to move forward and get out of that type of abusive relationship, because everyone deserves to be loved and respected. And if your mate is not providing you with that, there's no need for you to keep putting yourself in the situation to be disrespected. You have to raise your self-esteem.
And
you
also
have to love yourself more then you love your mate, because you have to come to grips that your life matters. Some of you ladies have kids that you need to be here for.
Right.
And if he kills you, now you're gone because you didn't want to lose his love. But he keep knocking you upside your head. He's not concerned about losing your love.
Definitely.
And also, you raising your kids in this domestic violence relationship, the impact that it had and the effects that it has on your child or your children's, that's another thing you might want to
transfer sometimes.
Definitely. And I'm going to piggyback what you're saying right now, too, because if it's a female that's being abused, she's teaching her daughters, if she have girls, that it's okay to be abused. And if she has a son, she's teaching her son to be an abuser, because that's how he's going to treat women, because they learn from what they see in their family.
And you also have to remember, if you go to get help and you're ready to get out, social service is not going to take your kids. They're going to help you get out the situation, because a lot of people don't want to tell no one because they're afraid. But if you keep your kids in that situation, you're taking a chance of losing your life, their life, or getting them took.
Right.
So at the end of the day, it's an all-lose situation for you with being in this situation. Because someone, if you stay there, someone eventually going to tell on you. Or you might lose your life, or you're going to lose your kids. But something's bad going to happen being there. So you need to just get the help that you need to get yourself out of there.
And if your kids, like she said, with social services, if they get called on a domestic violence call and their kids in the house, they have to remove them. Sad situation, but they do. It's either one of the parents leave immediately, if the parent is the aggressor and they leave, then you might be okay. And when I say might, it really depends on the social worker that comes out and their attitude towards domestic violence.
Yeah.
If they have bad experiences, then guess what? 90% of the time, they're going to take that kid. If
they can't take the child. What they will do is tell you that the aggressor has to leave and cannot be around. Now, if you choose to still let him come, because they're going to do that. Now, like you said, they have a bad experience. They're going to check up. They're going to spy. And they're going to do all of that. And if you're still dealing with him, yes, they are going to remove the kids. But they cannot take the kids just the first time.
Right. But and that's why I say it depends on the social worker. Because you know, by speaking to them, some of them lie.
They do. They do.
They might make the situation a little more serious than it really was. And that goes both ways. If it's a social worker that don't believe that, okay, it can be resolved and the parent can be moved, and it was something serious that the kid should have been removed immediately, they might tone it down.
Okay. But also, if you want to stay, you have the right to stay. But get your kids out. Find a family member or a friend that's willing to take your kids. Don't make them grow up in that relationship with you.
And don't be ashamed. A lot of women are ashamed to speak on it, like they don't want anyone to know. Don't be ashamed. It's happening all over the world.
It is.
Many different women. And tell somebody.
And you want to know.
Talk to somebody. Ask for some help.
It's both ways. And men are more ashamed than women, to be honest with you, to speak about them being abused.
Yeah,
because that would sound kind of bad. My lady whooping my ass.
Yeah, I mean, but it's true, but it happens. And you know what? It doesn't have domestic violence doesn't have any barriers.
Mm-mm.
Oh, I make good money. I'm not gonna get my ass whooped. That's a lie. I'm white. I'm Hispanic. That's a lie. It doesn't have no barriers.
It doesn't.
It doesn't care how much money you make. Doesn't care what race, color, ethnic background you are. It doesn't care if you live in.
Anybody can get it.
Exactly.
Exactly. It just depends on the person that you're dealing with.
Definitely.
If that person is a abusive person, you're going to get it. It don't matter. You can be the first lady. It's just the person that you chose to bring into your life. That person, you cannot change that. You can have the biggest paycheck. You can have the biggest house. You can have the nice cars. You could be the president of the company.
Right. But I don't think it could be our first lady, because I think she came from Chicago. I don't think she'll let Barack do, you know, nothing like that.
She might be the aggressor. She might be the aggressor.
Well, hopefully they keep their hands to themselves.
Exactly, exactly. But on a serious tip, though, domestic violence is no joke, and we care about your lives out there. All of us do. And that's why we're here doing this show, Real Women, Real Talk, and we want to talk
about my life, too.
But
I want to
say this. For the younger generation, because we are older, the younger generation, you guys think getting another Facebook or Instagram or going on your friend's Instagram to go see what he's doing, them are all signs of stalking. And if he's doing the same thing, them are signs of stalking. It's not cute. You a stalker.
You are a stalker.
And that's the first signs of you need to get some help. Oh, if you got to check on him, you don't need him.
Right.
If he got to check on you, you don't need him.
Right.
It's vice versa. And it has no age limit, and it carries no boundaries.
And you know what? I want to say some statistics, too. If you're in a domestic violence environment and your spouse, the abuser, has a gun, it is 500% more likely that you will be killed.
And if they carrying two guns, then maybe no, because no, it's not funny, because I'm serious, because you got some people, if he's abusive to other people, and if he's running around with two guns and he got to carry a gun, and he's an ex-felon and he's running around, look at the signs, because you got kids. First of all, why you want to be dealing with someone that's carrying a gun? That means that something's going on in his life that's kind of dangerous. So, you know, them are signs too.
Right. Like that song we played, I'm living like I can't die. You know what I'm saying? Some of those lyrics, you know what I'm saying? And that's part of a lifestyle. And I think that's the difference, because back in the early, when we was younger, they didn't discuss domestic violence. It wasn't really domestic violence. Oh, if a woman got her ass whooped, well, she shouldn't have did something. No.
Or that's their business.
Right. But it's not like that. First of all, nobody has a right to put their hands on you as an adult. You shouldn't be fighting nobody.
Nobody, right. No. Even if you, I mean, a kid, yeah, you could spank them. But, I mean, in a relationship, nobody has the right to put their hands on
exactly, you. Exactly. Exactly. And it doesn't matter, gay relationships, straight relationships, because...
Teenage relationships.
Oh, and you know what? Reading this domestic violence information... Teenagers are in the highest domestic violence relationships ever in today's age. And I don't know if it's because of society, what they see, but basically kids in relationships between the ages of 16 and 24, they have the highest. It's like one out of every four relationships is a domestic violent relationship. And it's sad that the numbers are so high. So if you need to educate yourself because you are an abuser and you really love your person that you're with and you don't want to hurt them and you don't want to end up in jail or end up killing somebody, get help yourself, because that is not right. Something is wrong with the picture.
Or, let me just cut you off real quick. If you're in a relationship and everybody is saying the same thing about you, hey, you're too aggressive, you're too violent, get some help, because something's wrong with you. If your boyfriends are all leaving you because of something is wrong with you, you know, that's just like them saying, hey, your breath stinks, then go to the dentist. You know,
management classes.
If everybody's saying, look, you know, you a stalker, you be checking, you know, my phone, and you do, get you some help. You don't need to be checking no grown man's phone. You know, somebody told me about their wife. They said, my wife be checking my phone and he's a cheater. And he said, and I said, well, why don't she check your phone? They've been together for years. And he said, you know, like I told her, hey, you ain't doing nothing but hurting your own feelings, because ain't nobody calling on my phone for you. You ain't getting no phone calls. That's a proven fact. He said, and I don't answer her phone because I know ain't nobody calling her phone for me. Mm. Now, that's a proven fact. Now, if she want to answer my phone, then that's her
business.
That's her business.
Definitely,
well,
definitely.
Stick your hand in the cookie jar. You find out who ate the last cookie. We also have to make sure the women know that sometimes they stay in the abusive relationship because they don't want to take the kids. They want to do a two-parent home. Sometimes that's not going to work.
Right.
You're going to have to separate, and they can visit. You can take them by there. But stay in an abusive relationship, because you don't want your kids to not have a dad or mom in the house.
Well, see, that goes back to the effect of being in an abusive relationship that it has on the kids. People thinking having this two-parent, but you guys are unstable. You guys are really not a family, for the simple fact is, who wants to see their mama getting beat up, or who wants to see their daddy getting beat up, you know, and eventually something bad's going to happen. Maybe one of the kids might get hurt in the mix of you guys fighting.
Definitely.
You know, so keeping your kids in an abusive relationship is just not good, period. It's no such thing as two-parent home when you guys got someone, one of the parents is being abused.
And then you're right, because one of those parents is being treated like a child. So it ain't no two adults on an equal level.
And sometimes it's both parents.
It is.
You can
it
have
is.
Both.
I didn't mean one to laugh, but that
both
is
of them
true.
Being aggressive.
It is. Because it is. Now, oh, you're not equal to me. You are like one of the kids. Mm-hmm. I dictate to you how you do things and how you don't do things.
Right, because sometimes, and you're right, that is really, really true. I agree with that, because sometimes that one that's aggressive, the sometimes they humiliate the other one.
Always
and like
be
you
demeaning.
Said, yeah, and sometimes they treat the kids better than they treat their spouse.
Exactly.
Well, they try
exactly.
to tear up their self-esteem, make them feel like no one else is going to want you but me.
Right.
No one else
but
wants
that starts,
you.
But that starts early on. To get you there, mm-hmm. to that beneath that child, they start breaking you down, slowly but surely. When they calling you and popping up on you, you know, if they know that you're out, if you at work and your spouse call you more than five times and it ain't a 911 emergency,
something's wrong with that picture.
That's when they're breaking, that's signs of them breaking you down right there. Or if they, you know, they know you out on a girls' night. Why are you calling? Is you sick? Right. Somebody at, is something, the house burned down?
Right. Or you know what? Even more than that, like, you at work and you pop up because I service the public, not, you know, but I've witnessed, you know, one of my coworkers, she's working and her dude pops in the office. First of all, you can tell that he shouldn't be there, or maybe he should be there because that's how he looks. So, but this is your man and you work here. So why is he sitting at your window like he's a participant being serviced?
She might have done faked some PTO and wasn't at the job before.
But them is still signs of something. It doesn't matter.
He like going to check on that.
Still signs of
bitch, you be lying. You ain't at the job.
Right. But you know.
But them is still, why is you faking like you at work? What do you got to hide?
She going to see that non-abuser.
Get rid of the abuser. Get rid of the abuser.
Yeah, but then it's going to make the situation a little worse.
It's
going to
be bad. Because you might get him hurt, too.
Well, you know what? I want to say, ladies, we had a good show. We're about to end this show. Again, thanks for watching. Wow. This is Selena Coleman, Real Women, Real Talk.
Nasty Nebu, Real Women, Real Talk.
Tasty J, Real Women, Real Talk. And we coming back next week with a good topic. Young versus old.
Definitely.
Who does it better?
The battle of who does it better.